Okay, so I wanted to start this class about structure, because again, as with all of these elements, we're all talking about the same thing as we kind of break it apart in its pieces. It doesn't work without all the others. So when we talk about story, we're talking about character and plot and all that other stuff. Of course we are. But I think it's going to help us to back up as a way of analyzing the stories that we're already in the middle of, whatever draft we're on, coming up with stories, deciding about which story to proceed with, to really back up and figure out why story. What is it? Why do we tell them? And even further back, why art? Why do we make stuff up? Why do we paint things that are already there in reality? What is this thing that human beings over and over, across time, across culture, we fictionalize, we create stuff, we're not satisfied with reality. Why? Because when I back up, I start to see elements that can make plays absolutely unforgettable, iconic, necessary. When people come to them, they go, that is me, that's what I need, or oh my God, I don't want to be that. So I have, you know. So when I've been certainly conscious of it in the last 6 months, but for many years I've been figuring out, why do we do this? And I love it, and I'm not gonna ever stop doing it. So if the answer is just because it's fun, I guess that's okay, and thus my career is just having fun, that's fine. But it's way more than that, and we all know it's more than that. So I want to start actually in the most universal way we can as we dig down into your story, your play, those moments, because what's important for me is figuring out where this all comes from. And what I realized, because of some fabulous science, but also a ton of just intuition, is that we make art because we need to organize and categorize and explain and understand and find a sense of coherence to a chaotic world. As they say, story is life with all the boring parts cut out. That's why. Because a lot of life is confusing, tedious, and stories aren't. If your story is confusing and tedious, I would suggest maybe you're in the wrong profession or hobby. So if that's the point, is finding coherence, finding a way to understand, then that again, just that much tells us what a good play needs to have in it. It needs to have a question that we are trying to find some coherence, some meaning to. And by the end, we're going to get some piece of it. We're not going to have the world figured out, but we're going to have some learning. Something will have been learned. So the other thing is, we are the highest element of social species on the planet. We need each other. We are obsessed with each other. More than any other creatures, we want people. We have to understand them. There's a magnetic draw to each other. That means that's why we're going to tell stories about people, and why theater specifically, even more than filming TV, which of course has people, there are live people in front of you. That's the heart of its magnetism. Because we can't, like a light, you just can't not look at it. Why? Well, because, again, to find coherence, we're trying to figure out how to do this life, how to do it well. Even if the base level is survival, and then once you figure that part out, we can, you know, go to the luxuries of how do you have a fun life? How do you have a meaningful life? How do you find satisfaction? And all of this has a people component. So your stories have to be human-sized. And even if there are gods in them, those gods are people. They're personified, right? This is where theater all begins with the Greeks, where we see their gods. Their gods walk on stage and have a monologue before the beginning of Trojan Women. So again, it's human size. We are looking for this coherence, but it's a coherence that we can swallow. It is a coherence that is our shape and form, something that we can do something about, right? It's not this a kind of coherence that that is so universal that it is outside of our parameters in any way. It's something that we can ponder, that we can grab a toe of. But most of all, story is how we learn. Everything that we do can be put together in a story. What we are learning, what we are trying to find from the story is, again, this coherence for how to have a good life, how to do, how to survive, how to find satisfaction, how to find meaning. Every story we can approach is either how do we love, how do we survive, how do we protect ourselves or others, and then of course we can get more and more complex as the world changes, theater changes, and our answers become a little bit more like, well, how do I manage loving two people at once? It's quite a luxury that some people are like, I can't even begin to think about that problem, much less the solution. But of course, now we have so many of our 20th century plays are something on that line. But all of it is going, what would I do in that scenario? That's what we're posing over and over and over again. If I were there, what would I do? If I were Hamlet and I knew that my dad was murdered by that guy, what would I do? If he were me, I would probably just go in a corner and cry about it, not do anything because I'm scared of conflict. But if you're Hamlet, you ponder the great questions of life, you attempt, you try to catch them, you try to punish them, but he just confessed, so he's going to go habit if I kill him now. Okay, wait, I'm going to wait. I need to really punish him, right? And thus, one of the great Western dramas is born. But the question of what would you do is the heart of every single play. So if that's a question that can start, that's one of the elements that we will discuss once we get there. We will discuss one of the core dramatic elements that you have to have is a question that somebody in the audience can go, oh man, what would I do? I don't know. And you'd think that somebody would only be able to do that if the person is like them. It's actually not true. You don't have to actually have anything to do with that person. They don't need to look like you, be in the same time period, resources, class, race, anything. Human experience is human experience. And again, this is why when we look at plays, we are just following the people. And we connect to their personhood, not the specifics that would align them, in any other way. One story about this that I absolutely adore and kind of illustrates this is, I always talk about Hamlet, I'm obsessed with Hamlet. It's such an incredible story. The four of you have been here three times are sick of Hamlet by now. But I was talking with the great social anthropologist, Jared Diamond, over dinner once. Wow. And I was asking him, he's a mentor of my husband's, and I was asking him, like, okay, his specialty is ancient cultures in Papua New Guinea. So I'm like, all right, so tell me about story. What do you see when you talk to them? Just this one group out of many. What are their stories like? What is there a pattern? Do you see these kind of, great archetypes or mythology? And he was like, no, I don't actually, they don't really tell many stories that I know of. And then he starts, well, there's this one time where a hunter that I knew really well was talking about, he was the only time I really saw him get emotional, because he was saying that a lot of the times that culture isn't as grounded in emotion or openness about emotion. He was like, and he was really upset because somebody had killed his father. And I was like, go on. He was like, and he wanted to do something about it. And he kept trying to confront him and to kill him. And I was like, so Hamlet, basically, is what you're saying. So Hamlet. Great. Okay. So yes, there is a pattern. Across ages and cultures, we have an issue. And again, what would you do? That is what this person, with no access to the great cultural icons that we have, he was processing the exact same thing that this fictional Dane of the greatest playwright in the world was processing. So something about that, there is a commonality. And it is, in fact, that commonality that makes me love theater ever more in this crazy time period right now. We are so much more alike than we are different. No matter where you go or who you voted for, we're actually dealing with the exact same stuff. And I think that is part of the superpowers of theater as a bridge. That's a bit beside the point, but just to put that out there, you're all superheroes for being here. So, okay, so what I want to talk about for a second in this biological space of, like, why theater? We need to learn, we need to connect, we need to understand. So I was thinking about this, what are some of the elements of story that make it so valuable? And the things that we pay attention to are people, we've just talked about that, they're just the magnets. But the other thing we pay attention to is patterns. And this is actually true in paintings, in music. We are paying attention to people and pattern. And frankly, where these two converge, and specifically where patterns start to break and shift, that's a story, right? These two are actually just it.
if you have people or personified characters, gods, you can have a rock that's in love with another rock, and that's fine too. But inherently, they're having human emotions. The pattern, and this is going to relate to structure and how we put this down on a page. It's where these two things come together. That's story. Over and over again, we're going to have to figure out why these people, and of course, all the things about humanity. What do you want? Who are you? What's at your core? What defines you? What are you terrified of? What do you think is beautiful? All of those things are going to funnel into this story or give you the ingredients for just unforgettable characters. And pattern is where we're going to find this plot, this continuous engine. The pattern, at the beginning of a story, right? There is a pattern set. The world is the way it is. The sun rises, the sun sets. That's actually not interesting as a story. It's where that pattern breaks, where the sun doesn't rise for one day. What? Now I'm paying attention, right? The pattern is broken, right? And that's just survival, right? We find, if the bees all go to one tree, the people pay attention, and suddenly they find this amazing source of rich, sugary honey that can sustain you in your primal form, right? If you keep getting attacked by a tiger because you leave your waste outside of your hut on the wherever you are, you're going to figure out how to break that pattern to save yourself. So that's why pattern matters to us. It either helps us or can protect us. So this is basic level humanity, survival, animalistic stuff. But I think if we realize that's what's at the heart of stories, how we tell them, why we tell them, and how we tell them that way, then you can really tap in to those essential feelings. And that's why we're here, is to feel the kind of like, whoa, this is universal. Right? This is what it is. So people in pattern make a story. But that's just kind of, again, primal stuff. The other things that are going to become obvious, but are helpful to think about in terms of this, the primal elements of what just interests us. We have beauty. A lot of these are kind of Aristotelian, but again, good to think about. You don't need all of them. Well, you need these two in your story, but all of these you can have in different levels. So beauty, for one. And of course, beauty is in the eye of the beholder, as they say, so it's very different and can be changeable. Grandeur, things that are so important. It doesn't necessarily mean size, but it just means a sizable impression. Extremes, right? We don't look at the middle of a beautiful mountain and are like, oh, that's gorgeous. We look at the top. So what's going on up there? How high does it go? What's above that? How do I get there? Right? So the extremes. We need bests and worsts. Again, if you're thinking of this in terms of pattern breaking and in terms of education, we need to figure out, how do I get the best and how do I avoid the worst? That's what Oedipus Rex is teaching you. Like, yeah, you're the king, best. Yes, you did all this awful stuff and you couldn't avoid it, worst. And you poke your eyes out, so you don't want to do that. So extremes are very important. The other thing is uniqueness. Things that are striking, that are extraordinary because of their the kind of solo aspect. What makes them pop out. Again, this is a reference to pattern. What is so different about this person, this thing, this moment. And it can be unique for the universe. It can be unique for me or this room. But all of those things are going to affect. Obviously, we would pay attention to that if we were on the savannas of ancient times. So thinking about these things. So the other thing, of course, which I can kind of, it's hard to categorize because they all kind of come in together. But we were also obsessed with horrible, awful things, right? It's the train wreck symptom. And of course, again, thinking about it in terms of we are obsessed by people because we empathize with them. We'll talk about empathy in a second. And we are obsessed with extremes, uniqueness, pattern breaking. Awful things tempt our eyes because, again, we're learning, how do I not get there? And if it can't be avoided, how the hell do I survive? So this, in terms of an extreme, that's going to make for addictive storytelling. It's again, it's hard knowing the way the world works now and the way the media works now and
all of that. But we have to honor the fact that we have evolved to pay attention to the awful. Now, in the world of theater, it doesn't mean put a nuclear bomb on stage. Yes, you could. But it just means that we can handle the worst. We actually want to see it. Because we're, again, biologically, I need to see so I can protect myself from it, so I can know how to avoid. Yeah?
I wanted to interject.
Yes.
I teach Shakespeare, so yeah. And right now we're working on Lear again.
Oh, great.
And, you read about Lear, and it's so awful, and yet it is one of the most popular plays to be mounted.
Exactly.
And it just, I never thought about it this way. It contains all of those.
All
things.
Of it. Every single one.
Time. Yeah.
Every single one.
Every single one.
Even a natural disaster. It has a storm in the middle of it.
Right.
Right? The worst of our, Lear is, Lear's so great, partly because the metaphor is both external and internal, or they metaphorize each other. So the idea of his madness descending is uncontrollable and extreme, and thus the storm in the middle when he is at his worst is uncontrollable and extreme. Terror can be a betrayal by your family. It can be a horrible mistake you realize too late. Spoiler alert, the end of Lear. And we also have beauty in it, right? Cordelia. The purity and the insistence on, no, I'm not going to play that game. No, I know what's right, and I'm going to, right, that's, oh my gosh, it's magnificent. So yes, the grandeur, right, this is why Shakespeare, the stakes are so high, because everybody's a king. Right, it's not just him, it's the kingdom, the country, the future of a people is at stake, manifested in that person, which is, again, people-sized. It's We can talk about madness and corruption, and it can feel too big to get a hold on, but if you manifest it in a person, literally manifest it, in Lear, now we can have a story, and we can have our own minds go, what would I do, most importantly? And then the artistry of metaphor, where we get to play with, oh man, he's not just going mad, the whole kingdom is falling apart, nature is rebelling. Again, this beautiful moment of a storm. Put a storm in your play. Just it's a perfect metaphor for everything. Yes. So, okay. So these are, and there will be more, and if you think of more, shout them out, and we'll put them up here. But so this is kind of why story, why art. But I did want to stop for a second. This is a fabulous and fascinating book called Art is Therapy. I had it on my shelf for a long time before I read it, but as I've been recently really interested in this question, why theater, why story, why art, this boiled it down into a really interesting set of principles that I think can apply, I'm sure, you can relate to as well as I can. And I just want to read them out because they're so smart. And this is actually mainly not about drama or cinema or story, it's mainly about art, visual art. But it makes perfect sense, and I think you'll see why. And again, thinking of this as creators, you can figure out in your play, do you have one or all of these? Do you have moments that your play can jump in here? That's the beginning of going, oh, this is gonna matter to people more than me. This is gonna start to be a universal story. Okay, so the chapter title is literally, what is the point of art? So there are seven scenarios that are basically human failings that art is a corrective to. So I'll read both. So one, we forget what matters. We can't hold on to an important but slippery experience. So art is a corrective of bad memory. Art makes memorable and renewable the fruits of experience. So we forget the good stuff and we forget the depth of the bad stuff. So we need to see it again over and over. We need to see Lear over and over and over to remind ourselves about family and power and greed, and also absolutely extraordinary love. Two, we have a proclivity to lose hope. True, totally, totally true. So art is a purveyor of hope. Art keeps pleasant and cheerful things in view. Also true. We have a clown in every one of Shakespeare's incredible tragedies, right? And I think drama particularly doesn't just have a stream of hopeful things. We like the kind of contrapuntal experience of having little hope, little sorrow, little hope, little sorrow. But it's true. Think about what is hopeful in your play. Doesn't necessarily end with unicorns and frappuccinos, but it can be a something that makes us go, we're going to be okay. There's a way through. Or because of this awful thing we've gone through, there's a way through. At the end of Lear, I often feel that. damn, we've been through that. At least everybody learned not to be Lear. So that's good news. And we sally forth with that, right? Okay, three, we incline towards feelings of isolation and persecution because we have an unrealistic sense of how much difficulty is normal, which seems to be opposite of what we just heard. So we feel isolated and victimized because we don't we don't know that a lot of that is normal. Mm-hmm. The things you go through as a human being, there's hard stuff at every turn, and there can be sorrow. But that is why art is, number three, a source of dignified sorrow, that you're not alone when you lose a parent, when you lose a child, God help you, when you're in the middle of a war and can't get out, when you voted for someone and they didn't win. There is a source of dignified sorrow in the theater, and I actually think that's one of the absolute superpowers of plays. I kind of have a bit of an obsession with how you approach death with grace and dignity and a sense that you mattered. And this is it addresses that exactly, this idea that we can approach the most sorrowful thing, the most terrible thing, and theater can let us go inside, and not just in a greeting card kind of way of like, you'll be fine. No, we're going to go in there. We're going to use that magical empathy of theater, and you're going to sit right next to that person in the same room with them, living and breathing, and we get to go, okay, they're getting through it. I can see the other side with them. And even if they don't get through it, you can be there in your heart and go, okay, again, what would I do? It makes you practice for the terrible and the sorrowful, which is a good day's work, I think. So four, we are unbalanced and lose sight of our best sides. I think that's fabulous. We aren't just one person, we're made of multiple selves, and we recognize that some of them are better than others. So art is a balancing agent. Art encodes with unusual clarity the essence of our good qualities and holds them up with our bad. So again, what's a great character? If they are only one thing, super boring, useless on stage, gonna be cut out in the next draft. But if they are at constant war with themselves, yes, I believe in justice, but I also just want all the money for me and my family. Okay, yes, I believe in the, I don't know, whatever, but you're gonna have exactly the opposite at some point in your life or constantly in your life. And it's that push and pull that art can put in front of us and actually say, no, that's normal. It's actually totally normal for you to be conflicted about all of these things. So five, we are hard to get to know. We are mysterious even to ourselves. So art is a guide to self-knowledge. It can help us identify what is central to ourselves. That's that key, what would I do question. You're gonna figure out or begin to answer it in a play. If the person you love doesn't love you back, okay, what would I do? Do I care about somebody else's love? How would I be able to release myself from that? How do I tell someone I love them? All of these things you'll start to answer for yourself as you go through a rom-com or something, which is helpful. Probably on your own, you may not have to answer that for yourself, or when you get into a situation in your own like that, you might freeze up and not know, but art can help you process and go, actually, no, I'd rather be confident in myself than put everything on the line for somebody else. Maybe that's that kind of person, or maybe you're not. That's part of the question. Okay, number six, we reject many experiences, people, places, and eras that have something important to offer because they come in the wrong wrapping or leave us disconnected. That's a little hard one to unpack, but the idea that if you look at another era or another culture and think, well, that won't apply to me, it does. Again, Hamlet in the middle of Papua New Guinea. we're all dealing with this kind of same stuff. So what theater and story and art can do is this amazing convergence of culture so that we all realize what the human experience is. And that diversity, even though it might be unique to you, which makes it fascinating, pretty soon down the line, you'll realize it's actually not very different from you at all. So that's part of why we love stories about people that are different from us, because again, it satisfies this. Ooh, unique, that's not me, I'd like to learn. And the satisfaction of going, oh, they are just like me, wow. Right, isn't that amazing? And the last thing is we are desensitized by familiarity. He goes a little further, and live in a commercially dominated world that highlights glamour. All right, but the main point of number seven is it's a resensitization tool. Art peels away our shell and saves us from our spoilt habitual disregard for what is around us. Basically, I think what that means is it allows us to focus, lean in, examine something small, and seemingly perhaps either insignificant or something, again, that doesn't apply to you directly, but of course, as you lean in, you see how extraordinary something is, how special something is, how moving the smallest thing can be, the smallest touch can be the ending of a play, can be the climax of a whole story because it means more than you think it means. But if we're used to this sellable kind of world where, oh, that intimacy is just for show, but then you see what intimacy is if it isn't, if it actually is authentic and real. And that's this goal of theater, is a kind of authenticity combined with artistry. All right. Thank you for letting me read those. I just find that so incredible and inspiring, and frankly a source of a lot of great moments, that if I look at my play and going, why isn't this connecting? I can go to some of those and go, oh, because she's not hitting bottom. She's not hitting the bottom of her sorrow. We just have to walk her right up there, put her down, pour the worst. and we're going to see what that happens. And I'll tell you over and over and over again, plays of mine that have gone there, that have gone to that distance, usually about sorrow, I have more emails, more conversations, more people coming up and saying, I had no idea that I felt this way, or thank you for writing something that's my story. It's not their story, and it is, and it's not, and it is. Right, so again, thinking about all of these as ways to heighten and focus your story will tap into the very essence of why we tell them at all, which isn't that exciting. I mean, that's the point, right? That's the point of all of this. Because it's not just entertainment. It's not just a passing of 2 hours' time. It's certainly not money. why we do this? It's because there is a universality, a commonality, this the kind of grand and yet absolutely minute perfection of humanity. And it's a funny word to use, perfect, for it, but it is, because even in all of the flaws and all of the dirt, that's actually what we want to see, to know that we're not alone in this, to give us a sense of, okay, when it gets bad. I do think of King Lear. Actually, there's a play that I'm doing. I haven't acted in a long time, but I've made myself do it for this play. It's kind of a one-person play, but it's about losing my father and my grandfather to Alzheimer's. And of course, what did I do? I go read Lear, because I don't know what's going on with him. He doesn't know me. I'm his oldest grand. He doesn't know me. What do? I go to Shakespeare. You know, when I was in high school and dealing with boys, I was like, what did Juliet do? It's not the best roadmap for that. But, right, so over and over again, we can stand up and meet betrayal and sorrow and joy in the theater. And it excites us. And it is this funny thing about art. That's why we make it up. Because life is confusing and it has terrible timing. But art focuses our attention on a journey, so that a person who wants to change something gives it their best shot. And at the end, this is the secret pattern, either they are changed or the world is changed because of them. So sometimes they get both. Sometimes the hero is changed and the community is changed around them. Sometimes they try to change, they almost get there, they don't make it, but the world changes anyway. It's gotta be one or the other. If they don't change and the world doesn't change, why did you tell us this story? So I think about that when I think about Romeo and Juliet or Hamlet or Lear or all of these things. If it is about corruption or civil war or madness and greed and madness laying waste to a community, none of the people in Hamlet, Romeo and Juliet, or Lear make it to the end, except for Horatio. Good job, Horatio. But the world has changed because of them. Right, that's the end of Romeo and Juliet, is everybody lays down their arms and are like, they didn't make it, but we're gonna change. Right, and that's that glimmer of hope, that glimmer that we have to have at the end. Oftentimes it feels cheesy, wrapped up. Again, this is kind of a structure question of, when you get to the end, what is the end? When do you know it's the end? How much of the end is too much? When do you say curtain and let the audience go back to their real lives? But that's part of it. Sometimes you can wrap things up too perfectly. There's always that, well, that has a bow and a bell and a cupcake on it. And sometimes, right, there's those endings that are go, but what? That's it. Right, don't you hate that feeling? I hate that feeling so much. You know, we're just a little too soon. I'm like, I needed a little bit more information to know that everything's going to be okay, or that it's not going to be okay, either way. Which, you know, those cliffhangers are fine for TV, but for theater, we need a little bit more like, and it's over. right, okay. So that was our social anthropology, evolutionary psychology lesson for today. But it's really cool. If you are interested in the science, there's a ton of stuff about this base cellular level as to why we might need story to learn the way we do, to connect the way we do. Which is, I find, pretty fascinating and makes our art form pretty extraordinary.
Who's the author of that book?
Alain de Botton, John Armstrong. I'll leave it around. It's gorgeous, too, and there's all these beautiful reproductions of paintings and things. So are there any questions on that? I love to think about the epic nature of what we do. I think that makes it so much more valuable and interesting, and the answer to those questions about some of us who've had who've been in the class before have talked about those plays that you still think about decades ago you saw them, or moments, and usually it's moments in a play. We'll talk about this idea of creating moments because that's really what sticks. We can't usually even contain a whole story in our recollection easily, but man, I remember this one performance of Hamlet, surprise, surprise, where poor Ophelia, instead of drowning, she is in a tub. If I told you, I think I told you this. Memory is so vivid. Actors Express, when I was like 14 in Atlanta, it's this wonderful company. Chris Coleman was running right at the time, and they did this amazing production of Hamlet. And it was my like 15th or 14th birthday, and I took all my friends to Hamlet. That's the kind of friend I had. Happy birthday, Lauren! Ophelia was in this white tub bathing, and the kind of scene was happening around her. She was like divorced from it. And at the end, when she's supposed to drown, they start hoisting her up to the ceiling, dripping wet, wearing this white dress. What? Oh my God. Right? That is unforgettable. I don't actually know if that's what happened, but in my mind, that's what happened. So something about that performance was that evocative, right? I don't even quite understand, I didn't even understand it that much when I was there. I don't even understand all of it now, but there's something about it that was so beautiful and terrible. Grand and extreme and unique, right? Check, 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 check. So finding the preview of our discussion about moments is finding places for your story to have that kind, that to have room for that kind of artistry to it. That's going to make it unforgettable. All right. I'm going to stop talking for a second, so if there's any questions or things you want to talk about. Yeah.
I'm thinking of myth and Joseph Campbell.
Yep.
And the writing, you know, that he's done, I think helps explain this as well.
Absolutely.
In terms of like many, many different people and how lots of stories come around again. And
over
again.
And over. Yeah, and actually there's this wonderful book, it's the one I was telling you about earlier, Into the Woods by John York. And he actually, these last couple chapters are about this, is that his argument is that what Joseph Campbell actually discovered was not the monomyth, but with story structure.
Okay.
It's the reason why we tell stories a certain way. But it's, again, that pattern is over and over again. We have someone who set out on a challenge because something is wrong. They try to fix it. They fail several times in several ways in increasingly terrible degree. And then they come home. Into the Woods, he calls it that because it's really about somebody going into the woods, coming back out changed. That's a story. People in pattern. You go in, you come back out. But yes, exactly. And thinking about that, I think, there's a danger of thinking about it as this well-made play model, which we have that term because there was this French playwright, 18-something or other, not literally, it was like 400-something, where he had his well-made play model, and he could have interns come and like fill in different character names and fill in different traits, and he would churn them out. Same thing kind of happened. Somebody, this, that, right, he has this moment, he has that moment, boom. And so there's this allergy to this sense of a well-made play that's built on structure. But of course, that's the extreme silly version. I think what a well-made play actually is it's a well-done story, a satisfying story. And you can satisfy in a lot of ways. Which is partly what we're going to talk about with the sense of structure. So this is like all of the why. We're about to get to the how. but I think knowing the why can start to answer for you the how. You're going to need these things. You're going to need a person who wants something. Okay, I'm just going to read you. Here's what a story is. All right, a story is a purposefully arranged, that's your job, and conveyed, that's the theater's job, series of events, so that's important, series of events, focusing on one character's choices and struggles, and the people of influence around her, that culminates in a moment of meaningful decision for that main character that defines her world and herself. I will say that again, or...
Yes, please.
You're like, you're going to have to, or write it down, or both. And then we'll kind of unpack that. All right, so a story is a purposefully arranged and conveyed series of events, that's important, series of events, focusing on one character, the choices and struggles of that character. So choice is the word, and struggle is the word. And the people of influence around that main character. And the whole story culminates in a moment of meaningful decision that that character has to make that will redefine her world and herself. That's what a story is.
One more time.
Yep. A story is a purposefully arranged and conveyed series of events focusing on one character's choices and struggles and the people of influence around her that culminates in a moment of meaningful decision that redefines her world and herself. It's not exactly high concept, but...
No, that's all right.
Yeah. So the idea being that we're going to design something that does this. That's what story structure is. It's the sense of we're going to aim the ingredients, the pattern. We're going to do this dynamically so that we have all of these things checked off.
Okay. Before you go on.
Yeah.
One more time. I didn't get the whole thing.
A story is a purposefully arranged and conveyed series of events focusing on one character's choices and struggles and the people of influence around her that culminate in a moment of meaningful decision for the main character that redefines her world and herself. So let's unpack it. So we have a series of events that focused on one character. We need a hero. I used to talk about dramatic structure only in terms of the hero. I've recently discovered, of course, that's stupidly wrong, which is why I added the people of influence around them. Those people are critical. Again, we are a highly social species. We don't do things by ourselves. So we are focusing on one character. It is about one person. It is Romeo's story more than it is Juliet's story, but you can't really do it without Juliet. And you can't do it without Tybalt, and you can't do it without Mercutio, right? So we have all these people that are deeply important, but it's Romeo's choices and actions that we're watching. So one character's choices, that's the huge word, choice, choice, choice. They have to make choices. They can make bad ones, they can make great ones, but it's all about the choices that they make. Why? Because choice is a response to information, and it precipitates action. So choices are the things that you make once you've gathered some information. You may make a wrong one if you don't have all the information, right, when Romeo decides to axe himself. Wrong information, fake news, bad choice. But a choice generally prompts an action, right? You don't just say, I will be king. You have to go do it now. It's the crux, the choice making, the decision in one's mind. That's the main thing you're influencing, right? It's the characters that have to wrestle with their own mind, right? You know those people. I'm kind of like that when I'm about eating for dinner. What do you want? I don't know. My husband's like, would you tell me what you want? I'm just gonna list things: Mexican, pizza, sushi. I'm like, yes, sushi's fine. Right? That's so annoying, and it doesn't do anything. It's not helpful. So that's why it's not fun for a character to be totally reactive to everyone else's choices. The main character, that's the hard part. Making a decision is hard. That's why when it's dinner time and I'm low blood sugar, I don't make it, because I'm too hard. I don't know. Just put food in my mouth. You're learning a lot about me right now. but that's why, that's so critical. Choice making. So again, everything I'm about to say is... a challenge for you to go, okay, when do they make that choice? How do I set it up so they have to make a choice? They can't go home and go, I don't know, choose for me. You have to make the You have to find the cauldron for this to happen, for this alchemy, for this chemical change in a person that would give them a choice to respond and make. So you have to find the choice to make. So the struggles. So back up. Series of events focusing on one character's choices, which I probably should have put this in the other order. Choices and struggles, right? The struggles are going to prompt the choices. And those choices that you make will probably prompt more struggles, which will prompt more choices, right? That's the series of dominoes we're playing with here. The struggles element is part of this pattern breaking, right? We usually start a story in a world where everything's fine. Harry Potter's life isn't great, but it is what it is. And then he reaches this breaking point, right? What actually happened in Harry Potter? That's too complicated. I'm going to switch. So, yeah, we're going to go back to Hamlet. We should always go back to Hamlet. Hamlet's, before the story begins, Hamlet's life is fine. His dad's king. It's all great. He's got a weird uncle, but it's fine. Okay, great. The struggle starts when Hamlet's dad dies, right? Now he's this mopey prince. So that's bad. But then it gets worse. Because in the second scene, a ghost shows up and tells him, not only is your dad dead, he was murdered by that guy, and points to his uncle. So that's a struggle. Now he's struggling. Oh my God, my dad, it wasn't just some happenstance, which is bad. Death is already hard enough. Now there was intention behind it. That makes me furious, rageful, and sorrowful all at once. And I know who did it, which means now he's got a choice. What's he gonna do? And we as the audience go, oh man, what would I do? I'd move. Right, move out of Gotham City. Everything bad happens in Gotham City. Right, so now he has this choice. The struggle prompts the choice. And then the choice to go after the king prompts more struggle. All right, how the hell do I do that? Now I'm caught. Now I'm, people seem to be dying all around me. Now I'm struggling with killing my own self, to be, not to be. Boom, boom, boom. So right, struggle and choice. So right, so next, and the people of influence around them. So this is where your craft is going to come up. Who are their friends? Who are the people that seem like friends but aren't? Who are the people that tell me exactly how it is? That kind of friend that you're like, you look fat in those jeans. Right? We need that person. These people aren't just landscape. They're not just furniture in the story. Of course, they are part of the choice making, the struggle, the person that holds them to the fire. It's the Horatio, right? You need a Horatio, but you also need Polonius, right? You need Ophelia and all of her strangeness, although I would totally rewrite Ophelia, but that's just me. Mm-hmm. Maybe add a few more women in your play than Hamlet, mm-hmm. Not to be critical. So that's really important to get that balance right. Again, all of this is to figure out the struggle and choice. And the ultimate choice that Hamlet is going to make, the ultimate question of Hamlet, is he going to avenge his father, not kill the king? Because you could avenge your father without killing, but that's probably where we're going. So all of this struggle and choice, there is going to be this meta question, which we will get to in a moment. Sorry. The people of influence, all right, around, the people of influence around her that culminates in a moment of meaningful decision for the main character. So that meaningful decision, of all the decisions, it's the one. And again, decision is prompted by information and prompts an action. So, but the decision that we reach in the very climactic moment of Hamlet is, so the information that happens right before is Laertes is dying, right? Spoiler. And he says the king's to blame, which is the final proof that Hamlet's been waiting for. Again, remember this scene, I should have had you read Hamlet, so just calling all this. The final moment where he is surrounded by all of the hoi polloi of Denmark society. It's a big public fight between the prince and and Laertes. It's a big deal. Everybody's eyes are watching on him. It's American Idol. Everybody's looking. And here Laertes says, to the entire room, the king's to blame. The king's right there. Right? Now everyone knows that the king's to blame. Hamlet was right. It's been proven. He is vindicated. So that's the information that happens right as Hamlet decides, yeah, I'm going to kill him. Follow my mother. Poison cup. All hell breaks loose. Right? So the actions, of course, was but yeah, the decision was, I shall kill him finally. So that's the big moment, and it answers the question that we started at the very beginning of the play. Are you going to avenge your dad or not? And he says at the end of that, when he learns about the ghost, curses spite that ever I was born to set it right. That's the end of that scene. We prompt into this five acts of madness. Okay. Right, so that is the meaningful decision. Again, what is that decision for your story? What is the crux at, you know, three-fourths of the way through, five-eighths of the way through the play? After that, intermission, if you have an intermission. If not, there's a moment of chaos, which we'll talk about, these dueling moments of chaos. You get to the end of the play. What is an end of the play? It is an answer to that question that we start at the beginning. It's not an answer to the philosophic question of the play. What is life? Blah, what is loyalty, what is a duty, and all that stuff. Those questions are never really answered, just continually asked over and over again. But the specific answer is going to happen at the end of the play, and it needs to have a decision. If it's a love story, the person finally says, I'm going to tell him I love him, I love you. Right? It might be a la Casablanca, I love you, goodbye forever. Right? Oh, that's so great. If you're in Miss Bennet, it's I love you, kiss, everything's happy, yay! right, okay, so, but the last element, so it's a meaningful decision of the main character, that's what culminates, that redefines her world and herself. So in that moment of Hamlet, that decision, Hamlet is deciding to be a killer. He's been wrestling with this. He's deciding, in that moment, the hero of our story is deciding, I would rather have this kind of vengeance than be the person that goes, good, I'm glad everybody knows that you're a killer. Done. No, he's like, no, I'm not done. You have to die. You have to die by my hand. Right? That's a different kind of decision than like, yay, justice has been served. No, he's, again, Hamlet is kind of dying, as is everyone else in the play at that moment. But, you know, again, that's a great moment. If Hamlet's dying, he's like, you're going with me, brother. So, but this is, that's what I mean, this redefinition moment. In Aristotelian terms, there's this anagnorisis. Wait, that's the reversal. What's the revelation? There's a word for revelation. And that's what happens at the end of a lot of Greek plays, and part of what Aristotle defined as part of an element of a good play is you have to have a revelation at the very end. And that's what this is. I think a decision is a revelation of who you really are. And this is where those wonderful concepts that we kind of talked about, these grand concepts, these extremes, these moments of terror and beauty, they're going to culminate in this decision. If you're a person, it's like Sophie's Choice is the way, right? You have to make a choice. Who are you in that moment? And that decision is also going to redefine the world. Because if Hamlet hadn't have done that, maybe King Claudius would have lived. Maybe the King of Norway wouldn't have taken over Denmark and the world, right? So there's lots of a reverberation to those decisions, but it's your job to figure out what is that critical decision that is going to define that person. All decisions define us. So Aristotle says it's what you do, not what you say, which of course we all know, again, instinctually. But oftentimes we write characters that say a lot but don't do anything. But doing is who you are. Doing is what you mean. Yeah, okay. So that's the like sentence version, the word problem version of dramatic structure. I will also pause for a moment to talk about something, about going back a little bit more of why art and why it's so damn dangerous to people who want to control a society. Why you try to sweep the artists away as quickly as you can if you're in some sort of authoritarian. Because of emotional intelligence. That's what art offers us. Because it's not statistics. It's not science. It's not even a well-framed essay. Art is emotional. And oftentimes, emotionality is equated with some sort of chaotic nature. Somebody is, it's often too emotional, right? That word floated around a lot when we're trying to make big political decisions. You know, emotion is bad. Emotion is unstable. But in fact, emotion is what makes us human. And storytelling informs us of that. And again, in that question, when we put a story together and it starts, we start to ask ourselves, what would I do? It is an emotional response that often helps us define that. Which is actually a good thing. Because emotions, even though it's a mix of chemistry in our bodies all the time, there is an emotional intelligence that gives us oftentimes a closer to truth, gets us closer to truth than information. Because information is, as we now know, easily manipulatable.
History is easily manipulatable. The story of time, we can, with a few words, change what we seem to know. But emotionally, if you see families ripped apart and the breadwinner of a family is being dragged away into a country and leaving five little kids, you know that's not right. You don't need any statistic to go, well, actually, if you look at the economic, no, wrong. That's totally wrong. Because you ask yourself, what would I do? I would be inconsolable. I wouldn't know how to go on, right? That's an emotional truth that storytelling, that visual art, that music gives us. We, right, the kind of amazing mathematical mystery of how music imparts information and emotion to us. But we feel it every time. So story after story, again, puts that to us as a way of practicing our emotional muscles so that when we hit that in real life, we go, yeah, I'm not going to be the person that allows that because I know through empathy and through this emotional intelligence. That's why art's dangerous, right? Because you get to practice justice and equality and those dangerous things that are made really obvious when they're put in human form and taken away from policy or, you know,
courage.
Numbers and stuff. Yeah, courage. There you go. Courage. Exactly. So again, those what is the emotionally important moment of your play? If your play kind of sails along, like, yeah, things kind of come at them and they bounce off, right? That's actually not going to be, it could be a fine play, and it could be a lovely evening's entertainment, but when is the point where the audience, right, grips their heart like that? Or if it's comedy, they can kind of go, oh, no, right? Usually comedy, you have a lot of wincing in those revelatory moments, or, of course, bursts of infectious laughter. That's when you know you're hitting the right peaks, right? Again, think of it as a song that kind of has three notes to it. It's gonna be fine. It could be a lullaby or whatever. But if it's Beethoven, we're going up. We're going down. We're slamming to a halt. We're right. That's again in this pattern-breaking way. That's what we want. If every scene has the same arc to it, the same, it doesn't go very high or very low. Again, fine. It could be fine. But you don't want a refined play. You want to write a play that's like, wow. Whew, that was a roller coaster, right? We always say a roller coaster. What's a good roller coaster? You go really high. You do a bunch of freaking flips. You feel like you're about to fall off. Right? That's what's fun. So thinking about that in terms of how you design your story. Now, we've spent a lot of time on the why of theater and art and story. Now we're going to try to look at the how. And yes, there is structure, engineering, architecture. I actually take great solace and inspiration thinking about it in terms of something I can build piece by piece. It takes some of the mysterious ominousness out of story building and playwriting, which that feeling when you're at the blank page and the cursor is going like that and you don't know what to do next. I like to have these elements, to have unpacked it, to have something that I can examine to figure out. Maybe I can mix and match and discover a story that satisfies. And it's really not about goodness or badness, it's about satisfaction. And satisfaction is different from person to person. What you're going to think, ooh, that was a great story, might be slightly different from a lot of people, but as things in the human condition tend to be, we're actually a lot alike about what we find satisfying. So this is where we're gonna start diving in here. I'm going to start by throwing out a bunch of things that I have found in a lot of reading and experience a story needs, and I'll try to put them in an order and see if we can come up with a rough shape that you can then apply and compare to the story you're hoping to tell or one that you're in the middle of, maybe as a way of going, maybe you can amp up the stakes here, add this element that your story doesn't quite have, and just those two things might redefine where you're going to get to something that will be satisfying artistically to you and to an audience. Okay, so So this is our line of time, obviously, as the play goes on, opening of the curtain, close. And I like to think of this as the kind of level of the stakes, the tension of the play, the kind of emotional grip that a play has at any one moment on time. Now, it's usually an actor term or a director term, raising the stakes. We kind of know what that means. It's the stakes of any decision have to be really high. It's not just the stakes of, do you have some gum or not? Right? Those stakes are fairly low. If you don't, it's like, all right. But if you have the antidote to this poison I am currently suffering from, stakes are really high, right? So we really want to aim the story so that the stakes get higher and higher and higher as we get towards that crucial moment of decision, self-definition, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, so a couple of things that a story needs. A hero, we've talked about this. This is the person, it's funny how even that can be hard to define or hard to commit to. Well, it's actually about this family more than just one person. Okay, but so part of the definition of a hero is whose action does the play follow? Who is taking steps, making decisions? Who is the forward momentum of the play? And a hero can be react obviously to the world around them, to antagonistic forces, etc. But it's their definitions that we're going forward. I love this person. I'm going to try to show them. It's my dad who was murdered. I'm going to do something about it. Right. So hero, we definitely need. A stasis, that's what happens before this catalytic moment at the beginning of the play to start the action or to start the necessity of decisions being made. So the stasis is the world as normal. And oftentimes that can actually happen before the play even starts. That's the Hamlet we don't see. But some plays do start there, so we see this moment of that disrupts the world. So at least if you don't see the stasis in your play, you need to know what it is or was. So this is a big differential. The hero must have an internal crisis, and the hero must have an external crisis. The internal being something that this character needs. What do they need it for? They need it for their own sanity, salvation, soul. It is something that they are struggling with that they actually don't really even know. Sometimes what it is, much less how to solve it. This will play out in a moment. And I know it sounds a little odd, but I'd like to think that's their need. This is in contrast to an external crisis, an external force, an external something that is pushing against them, something that they are fighting against. So that's the want. The want is, I need to fix this world. I need to fix this injustice. I need to fix the fact that I love that person. et cetera, et cetera. But these things are very different. The want, they know. The want is obvious. The want is, my dad was murdered and I know who did it. I want to punish that person, to find justice. This need, think of the need as a little bit more in that to be or not to be, liminal space. I'm incomplete. I don't actually know what completion looks like. I don't know what's wrong with me. But something is. This is the Hamlet that at the beginning is moping around like a big old boar. Right? Hamlet's mom keeps being like, what is wrong with you? something is, and that's before he knows what happened to his dad, right? So there's something incomplete. A puzzle piece is missing. And through the play, he finds this completion. Again, that he doesn't actually have a name for, much less a solution for, but it's through this play, even though this is the dark version. So at the end, it is taking action. To be or not to be is all about, I don't know what to do next. And at the end, what does he do? I know exactly what to do. You're going to die by my hand. And it's actually that sense of confidence
and clarity of mission that Hamlet was missing the whole time, or that he was kind of flirting with, and, well, I'm going to try to trick him into revealing, I'm going to pretend I'm crazy, and all this thing, when what it ended up needing to be done was him to go, I know you did it, the world knows you did it, now you're paying. Right? That's a Hamlet that is new to us until that very moment at the end. Even with the Yorick business, right there, he never just does anything. That's the joke about Hamlet. So, okay, so that's the difference between the want, very clear, obvious, external, and the need, mysterious, until through the actions of the play, this is the secret, the actions of the play will answer and solve this need in some way. Okay, another interesting element, a secret. Ideally a secret involving the hero. Sometimes it is the hero's secret. Sometimes the secret is external to the hero, but the hero will find out, and that's part of this moment and this moment. Secrets. Secrets are our friends. This is the people of influence around the said hero. They're really kin or strangers. It's not necessarily friends or foes, because kin and strangers could be either. The strangers could be the Good Samaritan that you know, but that you don't know but you need. And of course, a la Lear, your kin can be the worst of the worst. But it's really about this balance, I find. The people who know you well, that can either turn that into a bad thing or a good thing. And strangers who come in to the hero's life as either, oh my gosh, Juliet, you're Juliet. I don't know you, but now I love you. Or, I don't know you, but you're dangerous. This is this pattern-breaking element we were talking about, this uniqueness. All of that stuff is interesting. So think about who in your play you would categorize as kin. It doesn't actually have to be a family member, but a close friend, a confidant, etc., and strangers. And this could actually be a person that used to be kin, but they have changed so much they are a stranger now, right? Somebody who comes back after a long period changed, or somebody because of, I don't know, you can go all kinds of melodrama here, but some psychic break that makes them different, right? So that's a great element. All right, this is the fun stuff that kind of happens, starts happening as we approach the halfway point and towards the end of the play. Okay, I missed this one, opposition. This is kind of in this element in terms of the want and the need. Both want and need an opposition that is equal to how much this person wants and needs them. I.e., an opposition is not a very good opposition if it's easily surmounted. Right, so there needs to be this equal and opposite pull. Internally to the character, what their need is, needs to be balanced by, but it's too hard for me to deal with, or I'm too scared of approaching that need in my mind, or, right, the fear and the ambition need to be exactly equal. And it's the same with the external want, right? Killing a sitting king is not super easy, right? Even if you are the prince, as our dear prince. Our dear Dane is. Right, so it has to be hard, or else it's no fun. Telling someone you love can be the hardest thing in the world, as easy as it sounds in comparison to, you know, assassinating a king. Yeah, okay, so equal and opposite. We should write that. Equal and opposite. That's just how we're going to make it believable, keep that engine going, keep the dominoes falling. Again, if it's too easy, the play's going to be over in 2 minutes. Okay. So these are things that I've started to realize, at least my plays need. When I ask why this play is done too quickly, it's only 50 pages long, what am I doing wrong? Or it's just kind of flat, I don't care about the characters, right? You always hit that point, some plays where you're like, I don't like them or care. Chaotic peaks. So these are these actual peaks, visual diagram to help you. Chaotic peaks. What I mean is moments in the play when things were going well, or questions were starting to be answered, and suddenly they're not. There is this element of chaos thrown in. They are often also, down here, an emotional rupturing point. So I will use, I was gonna use Miss Bennett. That's a little weird to talk about one's own play, but I'll do it anyway. Partly because it's fairly easy structure as far as romantic stories tend to fall easily into structures. This is the act break, at the peak of this. This moment. What is chaotic about it is there is a stranger that shows up right at the end of the act.
right as they are like, hey, I like you. Do you like me? I think you might. Okay, this is going well. This is going good. All right, here we go. And oh my God, fiance enters. One of the people has a fiance. It's a little upsets things. Suddenly, you know, the play might have ended right there, except for this new element, this chaotic element that now throws everything. And you notice that we're not back here after the act. We're not back all the way to where the stakes are low, because now we care. Whatever happens, the audience and the characters at this point care, and so the stakes are higher. Stakes are when you have to care for the stakes to be high. So at this point, it's usually right at halfway through the play. Even if there's no act break in your play, there's going to be something right in the middle there that makes things all the more impossible, all the more complicated, all the more hard for your character to accomplish. Often because it adds a new complication. We were just getting a handle on the old complication, and now there's something new to deal with. I like to think of them as chaotic peaks, because often this is a chance to really write some amazing moments, which we will, I'm just gonna write that down so I remember to talk about that. Right, plays are just made of amazing moments. And oftentimes what helps me is if I have a play, and even if we're getting close to premiering the darn thing, I have to think about what moment am I missing? Is there a moment in this play that has a chaotic peak, that has an emotional rupture, that has a moment of offering or sacrifice, that has a moral inflection point where someone, usually that's called the decision, but I wanted to break it down a little bit. Right, these are moments that you can put in your play if they're not there, or you can design around them as you're building. But if they're not, I'm telling you, you're missing an opportunity to really go deep. These are the moments that are often the most fun slash challenging for actors, right? Think of what would be so amazing to perform. This chaotic peak when Mercutio dies, right? That huge fight that gets out of hand, and suddenly one of our favorite characters is dying in front of us. What? And dying so beautifully and eloquently. Right, that's an amazing moment. And there's that joke in Shakespeare in Love, like, I die, halfway through the play, I die. And then he's like, it's a good death scene towards the end, right? Because it's great, that's unforgettable, that moment. Does your play have a moment that has chaos, something happens, it changes everything, right? That's that moment, I think that would probably be right for Romeo and Juliet. That's right about halfway through, yeah. When Mercutio dies. Right, what a moment, unforgettable, changes everything, right? Romeo is now not just like their families didn't like each other. Yeah, now somebody died. And then of course Tybalt's dying, Mercutio's, everybody's dying, right? Suddenly we've taken what was already a complicated love story to an almost impossible, no, you can't be with her now. You can't, this is bloody again, bloody battles now, right? Okay, so challenging yourself, where is that moment when all hell breaks loose? I like to think of it as the oh shit moment. Ah, shit. So in Our Dear Miss Bennet, not quite so bloody as Romeo and Juliet and Hamlet, this is a moment that seems to redefine everything, that makes their love almost impossible. And it was actually a fabulous note by a wonderful director, Sarah Rasmussen. Margot and I were stuck about this play. And it was like, it's good, but I don't know, it doesn't feel like, what's wrong with it? And Sarah, we gave it to Sarah to read, because she's a great Austin fan and a fabulous director who's worked with both of us. And it was her insight to go, well, what happens in Jane Austen is there's a moment when their love is impossible. It is you cannot do it. It's not just inconvenient. It's not just like, oh, that would be awkward. No, you can't, absolutely can't. Usually involves someone else is married to whatever, like this works in Bronte's too. No, you can't, he has a wife. Sorry, you can't, done, right? But nothing is done in the theater. We shall persevere, and yet she persisted. So at this moment, that's what we realized we needed. We need to have that impossibility, that moment of like, oh, your adorable, awkward nerd love is fun to watch, but now we're gonna make it hard. So the second act, that's what's driving that second act, is now we have to deal with this fiance that he didn't actually even know about, but accepts because it seems like it makes sense, and she's like, you had a fiance the whole time, now I hate you. Awesome. So now that's impossible on her side, impossible on his side. Suddenly we get the fun of trying to untangle that, trying to get to a point of this second chaotic peak, this moral inflection point. Actually, this peak is usually all of these at once. This one is probably like one or two. But this will be the climactic moment of the whole play, and there's chaos, right? In our adorable Miss Bennett, it is a chaos of the family's together, people are coming and going, he's leaving, she's trying to, you know, there's a moral inflection point. Both he and she have to make a big decision that defines them both. Is she going to be the person that lets the love of her life walk out the door and go, well, I couldn't say it to him, I didn't want to, he should have known. No, she's going to be the person that's like, hey, I like you. You don't have to marry her, you should marry me. Right? That's actually really hard to say. I can't imagine ever saying that in my life. Right? That's you put your characters through the things that you can't imagine doing. Right? But that's what's fun. We all know that they like each other. It's not like a great mystery. At this point in the play, we're like, somebody's got to tell her. You've got to tell her. You've got to stop and tell her. There's always that's what I love about Jane Austen is the whole like, kiss her. my husband hates watching Jane Austen movies with me because I'm just like, kiss. But that means that it's working, right? Yeah. I'm invested. I care. I want that for them because I know what they want because, right. So at that point, she has to make this big decision of being honest and saying a thing that you're not supposed to say in Regency England. It's supposed to be all buttoned up and unemotional about it. And he has to make the bigger decision, which is to say no to his fiance. I don't love you. That's a huge thing to say, and to decide, and to say I do love you, and I'm going to do the hard thing of moving forward. Right? Again, love stories make this quite easy because the want is very obvious. We all know what it's like to be in lust or love or something. But again, not just one moral inflection point, but two. A chaotic peak. There's all this going on. They have to literally stop him from walking out the door to have this interaction. It's not like everyone's just sitting waiting for these decisions to be made. You have to stop the world to do it. An emotional rupture. She has to put it all on the line and kind of go, no, you're doing it wrong. He has to as well in his, you know, this is a character that's a little Darcy-ish, so it's not quite an emotional rupture because they're all British, but, you know, for British people, it is an emotional rupture. And the offering and sacrifice is there too. She is offering herself, really, not just in a, like, marry me kind of chattel way, but offering the vulnerability of honesty. That's really what she's offering. This is a naked moment, so I'm gonna be totally vulnerable for you right now and say what I actually think and feel, which is one of the bigger things one can do in this one's life. Yes, okay. So if we think about these two moments as really what your play is building towards and around, we have to have those to have a play. And the figuring out of what's in between these things, what sets them off so that we earn both of these moments, that's the real hard work. That's the engineering. But if you know that you have to have two chaotic peaks, two moments of where new information, it's all on the line, you have to have these emotional moments where the stakes are as high as they've been so far, right? We have to understand them, that that's what we're building towards. Then it makes it a little easier to build, right? Yes, okay, so now I'm gonna actually back up and talk about step by step. We're gonna plot out a play. All right, here we go. Which is the best marker? Let's find the best marker. Ooh, that's a good one. Okay. So again, this is not gonna fit exactly with what you're doing, nor does it need to. But the idea and the challenge is to ask yourself, what of this does my play have naturally? Like, man, I've got internal crisis in spades. Whew, these are messed up people. What I need is some external driver, some external goal, right? So you can kind of pick what's going to help. And I will say, the goal of this is not to get every story to be the same, to sound the same, to end the same. It's just these elements are going to make it juicy, rich, actable, dramatic, going to keep it away from being like just a short story on stage, going to keep it from having so much, poeticism to it that we don't have any grounded emotion, right? It can be so beautiful that it's not real, or the other way around, so gritty that like, but where's the hope? Where's beauty? Right? So we're going to try to find what's going to work for you, but especially if you see like, I don't know if I have a secret. Nobody has any secrets in my play. Maybe they should. Maybe you should take something that is super well known by all the characters and make it a secret and see what that does towards throughout the journey. If we didn't know we were adopted, that's an obvious one. I used to always joke about that to my sister. You're adopted. She didn't like it. Okay. All right. So Here we go at the beginning. Something is wrong in the hero's world. This is kind of ish right there. So something is wrong in the hero's world. She needs something. It's a deep need. The hero doesn't know what she needs. But there is hope for a better world or a better life if she finds this out. So this is the actual, this beginning of this dance between need and want, towards the beginning. So a series of occurrences, starting with a catalyst that sets the hero's want into motion. This is, we're gonna lose our house if we don't, whatever. This is Hamlet's figuring out the information about his, who killed his dad, and that it was murder instead of natural death, etc. This is the big information that's gonna set this character's external on. But there is hope. You know, basically, why bother with a journey if there's no hope? So we have to have some sense of, I can make this world better if I do this, or myself better. Okay, a series of occurrences make the hero's want clear. This is where we get that information. Again, a scene or two into Hamlet, actually, what the hero actually wants. Again, he doesn't know what he needs yet, but he knows after hearing about the ghost and talking to the ghost what he wants. So a series of occurrences make the hero's want clear such that a goal emerges. With that goal, for Hamlet it's justice, a plan emerges, or if you're Hamlet, like 10 plans. A plan emerges. I'm going to enact justice. Also, this is probably, you know, we're still in the first fourth of the play at this point. A team emerges. Kin or stranger, there will be a team. The hero's need is still unknown, but the ignorance that you have a need and what it is starts to thaw at this moment. So again, we're still in like this part of the play where we get all of our, we get our team, we have our goal, Hamlet has Horatio, Hamlet thinks he has Rosencrantz and Guildenstern and realizes, no, you're not so much on my team. You're a pawn, but I can use you and later kill you. Spoiler. Okay, so, yes. So now we're going to move into this next part. A series of actions and attempts that confirm the hero's desire to start to take place. So this is a different way of thinking about it. It's not like you are actively getting your goal. You're confirming, oh, I do want that, right? That's part of what the goal is do I, oh God, this is gonna be hard. Do I still want it? Even if it's that hard, do you want it? Even if it's this hard, do you want it? How much do you want it? So you're gonna confirm that the hero does want this goal and how hard it is. Again, if the goal is super easy to get, it's gonna be a short play. So we need to confirm your the hero's desire and the hero and the goal's difficulty. I.e., this is harder than the hero thought, and that her personal cohort is not enough to accomplish it. Horatio's not gonna be enough to deal with it. You're gonna have to now enlist poor Ophelia, even though she doesn't know she's being enlisted. You're gonna have to tackle Gertrude. It's Polonia, it's everybody, right? Now we have these actors coming in. He's gonna do the play to catch the conscience of the king, etc. So, right. The hero's personal toolbox and their cohort aren't enough to accomplish it. Yeah.
Yeah. So is this, are you talking about the team or that was introduced prior to this or are these new people too?
No, I think it's the people that they have around them.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
At some point you're going to realize I don't have enough. And our dear Miss Bennett, her sisters aren't enough. Her sisters are like, no, you're great, Mary, you're great. She's like, yeah, thanks. I don't want to be in the attic like you want to put me. I want to be my own person, right? But her sisters don't understand that, i.e. they're not enough for her. She has to define herself for Hamlet. Of course, there's a lot of people that aren't enough for Hamlet. Okay, so ish here, we have this chaotic peak. And either right before, right after, there are moments of giving up and moments of perseverance. And that's really what all of these attempts are for Hamlet. And for Hamlet, for Ms. Bennett, for everybody. The scenes, which actually kind of work like this, have peaks of their own, right? Every scene has its own peak, its own climactic moment of emotional release, of decision. That's what a scene is an effort at a decision. A decision is reached so we can move on. So each one of these peaks would be that emotional decision, depending on how many scenes your play has. But there are moments of giving up and moments of perseverance. After the play, you know, it worked, but then it didn't work enough. We hear the confession of the king, but he's praying, so it didn't work. We have this, we have that, right? When do your characters give up? How do they pick themselves back up and move on so that the play doesn't end, right? So here, in this very moment, is a huge moment of change and chaos in the hero's world. For Miss Bennett, this new character comes on and disrupts everything. This is halfway through the story. Things are upended, made harder, weirder, and more urgent. This is that oh shit moment, which we shall be crude and just write down. Oh shit. This is a moment where Romeo could have turned back and have been like, Tybalt and Mercutio, look, Mercutio's gone, I can't go on anymore, right? But instead, he's like, nope, don't give up. Sally forth, make further terrible decisions that we will watch with glee. But the big moment is, halfway through, there's something really does change. Again, this is that moment where if this doesn't happen, you get that second act lag, when you're like, why am I watching this again? You've been in plays like that, right? Where you're just like, what is the point? why do I care any longer? That's when you have to throw in some other canon that blows things up and makes it harder, but also deeply more interesting. Okay. So now we're in this the last second half of the play. So that was our oh shit that propels us in this direction. With the obstacle doubled, our hero reaches the end of her known strength. So now, even though she realized her cohort wasn't enough, now she realized she might not be enough. This is the second act, kind of redoubling, putting yourself back together. Okay. So her known strength, the limit of her known strength are reached, and she must admit a vulnerability. The beginning of Act Two, we talked about this last time, there is a moment there's an emotional breaking point, this emotional rupture. Usually happens right here in response to this. And Miss Bennett, she's just over it. She's kind of losing her mind with pettiness and and rage. She lashes out at her sister. She lashes out at the guy. She's like, I don't want to talk to you, and leaves. And another play of mine, The Book of Will, this moment is a really, really powerful moment of grief. And so the first part of Act Two is this absolutely naked exploration of grief. And in all that that is, it's an odd thing to say, but my favorite part of grief, because it resonates with me, a story about grief is when somebody just yells at God, how could you? How could you? What is wrong with you? Right, don't you, I'm sure, in moments of grief and sorrow have that of like, what the hell? Why would any good God do this? Right, that's beautiful for the stage too. Partly again, because we're all in it together. We all know what that's like. But this is what, when that space is, this how could you? This emotional rupture. If it's a love story, you can direct that less at God and more towards the other person, or screw it, love is stupid. I hate love. Love's always hurt me, so I'm not going to love anymore. Right? That's kind of an insane thing to say, and also a lot of us will go, I've been there. I know what you mean. So this is a part for that vulnerability, that nakedness, the kind of the charge of when you don't give a crap anymore, right? And also knowing your limits. I can't handle this. I can't handle it. I don't want to go on. I can't. As Beckett says, I can't go on. I will go on. All right. So this emotional breaking point. Right about here, about halfway through the second act, we start getting that recharge again. So the character realizes she's not enough, she's at this emotional breaking point, but she must put the last of herself on the line to accomplish this, to accomplish this goal. She must offer some sort of sacrifice. She must reveal her true self. These things probably they know, but they don't want to do it, right? This is where our equal and opposite obstacle. You know you're going to have to give it your all, but what does that mean? Would you die for this? Would you murder for it? Would you give everything you have in resources for it? Would you sacrifice your family for it? right? How much of yourself can you put it on? Can you put on the line? Your dignity, right? There's a lot of things we can offer ourselves. So you must reveal herself. So how does she reveal herself? Through a single choice. Now we're aiming right towards here. We're aiming right at that choice that they know they're gonna have to make. But God help you if you have to do it, if you're in that position. That's gonna be really hard or really uncomfortable if it's a love story. So it's through a single choice. If this is the oh shit moment, if this is the oh God moment, this is it. This is the moment that you're gonna have to know yourself. Again, we talked about that redefining moment, the decision that's really, are you a killer or aren't you? Do you believe in love or don't you? Do you believe in justice or not? All the big things, right? The ones that you're like, oh, I would rather not answer that question firmly, please. So much easier if I didn't. Okay, so the result of this reveal, this sacrifice, this vulnerability, this moment of recognition is the recognition of their own need, right? So through this last chunk of the play, the last fourth of the play, the hero is going to actually start to be able to say, I know what I need. I know what I need. I know what I want. The want is the external thing that I can do something about, but the need is that deeper thing that I haven't even had a word for yet. And now I'm starting to know it because I'm, again, with vulnerability, the nakedness, the emotion. You're going to start to know what's actually deep inside you. So the answer to the internal crisis, that sticky, mysterious thing, is part of this moment, right? So it's not just plot, 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 action, action, action. This is character, right? This is the definition of character, that the decision of that moment. So the surprising yet inevitable, I love that duo because it sounds impossible, and yet you know what it's like when you see a great play that accomplishes that. The surprising yet inevitable solution to this need is part of what this decision in this moment accomplishes. The character has proven herself in this moment. She knows who she really is or what she has become. That can be in the good way or the bad way. Right, in Lear, you know, he's an asshole the whole way through. He's a crazy asshole. But in that last moment, stripped of power, stripped of mental function, stripped of everything, even clothing, he's a great dad. He knows love. He knows who was there for him. He recognizes purity. And he's good in that last moment. Of course, it's all the more tragic because all is lost. But in that moment, he knows who loves him. And that's pretty extraordinary. So yes, this is the moment to prove yourself. Which, of course, we have to work back all the way back here to figure out what would that be? What are they trying to prove? Again, if we think of this is where we're going, kind of need to start in the opposite here so that we have the longest way to go to get there. That's part of this balancing act, right? The simple version is if you know they're going to get together at the end, got to make it really them not want to get together or it would be impossible for them to get together towards the end. Or else we get there too quickly. The same is true in all of these stories. So what's the we got to start with the opposite to get us there. All right. So whether they achieve their outward goal, their want, is actually immaterial. And this is a new revelation for me. It used to be that I would design through engineering and architectural terms. The whole point of the play is: do they get what they want? Do they get what they want? Do they get what they want? It actually doesn't freaking matter because it's the journey, as they say. It's the journey, not the destination. The journey is going to define them. And that's actually what we're paying attention to. We want to see who they are, because that's our big question in life. Who am I? But who am I really? And again, if it's not what we say but what we do, we are watching what people do. And frankly, the conflict of that. I like to say I'm a nice person. I even like to think I'm a nice person. Am I? I have to test me to figure out, do I walk by that homeless person or do I give the money? All right, so in this moment, again, whether they achieve that goal, Hamlet achieved the goal. He did get vengeance. He also lost his own life, killed a lot of people along the way. The kind of one of the ultimate goals is ridding of the rottenness of Denmark, right? The rotten Denmark is a state of rottenness when we begin. So at the end, a lot of the rottenness is dead. King is dead, Queen is dead, Polonius, everybody's dead. Hamlet, I think Hamlet realizes he was a part of that rottenness and couldn't even avoid it, right? But in the end, even though Hamlet's goal is accomplished, that inner need is met every single time in the play. So even if they don't achieve their goal, or they achieve it kind of, or whatever, the inner goal is met every time, even if they lose something in the end. That's also new to me. This idea of what they're finding through this journey is what they need. And it may be hard, it may be unexpected, it may be something that they, again, purposely, they have no idea how to even say it towards the end. Again, in the love story, our dear Miss Bennet didn't know that she needed not love and not even affection, she needed to be understood. She needed somebody who said, I get you, I totally get you. That's why this was such a betrayal. She thought somebody was there, and then somebody walks in, you've been lying this whole time? If you've been lying about understanding me, screw it, I'm out, I'm done. Love is stupid and I'm never talking to anyone again. So at this moment, even if, as in our Casablanca love story, they get each other, they're meant to be together, and they're not going to be together. Even if that's the want, right? From the very beginning of all the gin joints and all the whatever, she walks into mine, right? Oh, such a good movie. It's so funny. I always forget how funny that movie is. Anyway, so yeah, we know that it's a love story. They want to be together, right? Even though they don't get together at the end. She flies off on the plane, but his inner need is met. He actually is a good guy. He thinks himself as not caring about people. I don't care about politics. I stay out of it. I just own the bar. At the end, he's revolutionary. He's a rebel, and he's going to fight for the good guys, right? Which is, he didn't know he needed it. He didn't even want to need that. But in the end, that's who he is because of that decision, right? Go away. I love you. We'll always have Paris. Peace out. Right, so in fact, a lot of what is exciting and memorable and really that kind of beautiful heartache of a lot of plays is when these things are antithetical to each other. They're the kind of dialectic pushing against each other. So the great thing is I always try to think of it as, do you actually want, what you think you want? So you get to the end and you go, oh, I thought I wanted this. Oh, I got that. And I didn't want it after all, or I didn't need it after all, or these things are different. There's always a moment when you realize what you need. You can't always get what you want. Sometimes you get what you need. Yeah. So again, this is actually new to me because I love kind of tinkering and thinking about things in a more mechanical way. My husband is a scientist, and he always makes fun of me that he's way more artistically minded than I am. I'm much more engineering and mathy than he is. Because I like structure, and I want to figure out, okay, well, how do you, if you put this next to this next to this, does it equal goodness, good art? But it's actually a lot of these elements that can be reappropriated and renamed and put hats on in different ways. And we can find satisfaction, as I said before, in a lot of different ways. But over and over again, the things that are going to give us that emotional grip, the kind of like heart-stopping, like, oh my God, what are they going to do, have a lot of these elements to them. And so often what I see in plays that can actually be great, they're fine plays, they're good plays, but the stakes aren't high enough, the emotional bottoming out isn't there, people are frankly far too reasonable, and we're not here to watch reasonable people, even if you're very reasonable in life. We are here to watch people be unreasonable, not because it's crazy or funny, because doing something, as Aristotle says, a character's action is either by because that's who they are or because it's necessary. Those can be the same thing, but if you are in the middle of a crisis, this may not be an action that you would ever do, but you have to because you are pushed to it because of one of those chaotic, either oh shit or an oh God moment. So finding moments where your characters have to surprise themselves with what they are capable of or the depths they are willing to sink, that's what we're watching. Again, going back to the kind of biology of why theater, because again, we're asking, what if that were me? Would I have integrity or not? Would I have helped people get out of Germany or not?
we all like to think we would have. I don't know. I might not have. To be told, you know, totally honestly, a lot of us wouldn't have, because a lot of them didn't. And I think that's the human condition, is continuing to ask ourselves, if things got that bad, what would I do? If I met someone that was so amazing, and the person I've been searching for my whole life, but I was married with 5 kids, what would you do? What would you do? Oh my God, they're perfect, they're you, oh my God. Totally different types of stories, those two, but the crisis is the same. So crisis tends to redefine us in good ways and bad, right? And that's what we're watching. So making sure that your people aren't reasonable all the time, and they aren't right all the time. That's another mistake that I often find too, is my characters are too thoughtful. They are too, in the effort of getting what they want, I try to, you know, it's like the characters are too smart, so they get there. Hamlet makes a lot of mistakes, and makes a lot of bad choices, and your characters have to as well. So, another small list. So I said, oh yes, reasonable action, not being reasonable. It is back to our list. It's actions have to have extremes in place. It's about extreme action, because crisis prompts extreme action. And it's extreme instinct and extreme emotion. And reasonableness isn't just in the mind, right? It's in the heart too. So when your characters lose it, when are they out of composure? Again, I don't actually care about seeing a play. This is why Shaw can be fabulous, but oftentimes I'm a little like, take your jackets off, everybody. Like, come on. If you love her, just go kiss her. Come on, guys. Take your corsets off. Because we need those moments where you go, all right, if your stakes are high enough, people lose their shit. And we actually want to see what it's like. Again, as an educational treatise on what happens if you know you're going to die. What happens if your best friend or your child or your partner is going to die and you can't do anything about it. I hope I never have to know what that's like. But just in case, show me a story to tell me about what that might be like. So oftentimes in my plays, I'm dealing with this right now, where I like the play, I like where it's going, I know where it's going, I actually have the end, it's working beautifully, I'm super excited about it. But there's moments that are missing. And again, going back to this sense of, plays aren't even scenes, they're moments. Every single play is this series of these dominoes. There's a fabulous book called Backwards and Forwards by David Ball, which if you haven't read it, it's extraordinary. Slim, and like every page you just have to put down and think about it for an hour because it's so rich. He talks about it as dominoes, those dominoes, and they don't go backwards, right? So and they don't go to the side and they don't hang out for a while, right? Every domino is constantly in either a state of ready to be fall down or falling down or down. Right? There's no sense of like hesitating, like So we don't pause in plays. We don't detour. It's not like novels where we can kind of sidetrack for a moment. Plays go forward, kind of like a train. But often these moments, I find myself asking in the kind of callous way. It's kind of about, pardon my crudeness, fucking or fighting. Do you have enough moments in your plays where there is moments that I find usually in 3 categories that I tend to forget to put in? Like they can be nice, like the themes are working, there's quippy dialogue, banter is good, blah, blah, blah. But I tend to have 3 categories where I have to go, all right, Lauren, you keep doing this, you keep forgetting this. So it's either moments of intimacy, hug, a touch, physical touch. Amazing how we forget that these are going to be, our characters are going to be embodied by real bodies, and that how powerful a touch, a glance, a hug is. It's amazing what a hug will do in the middle of a play. Okay, so either I forget moments of intimacy, I forget moments of aggression. I always like to ask, who gets slapped in this play? Probably not good to start the play with a slap, although I did do that actually once. It can be good exposition too. Right, because that is this moment of aggression, this moment of fall down, like, no, you're not walking away from me, we're gonna have this fight right now. Or like, you said what? Psh,
Right, it can be exhilarating. It gives you a ton of, again, that emotional intelligence, gives you a lot of emotional information, and it raises the stakes. It really punctures the story in a great way. Again, you don't have to have all of these, but I usually have, you don't need to slap in every play, but you certainly need a moment where somebody loses it enough to go, you are completely kidding me right now, right? Right, that they just lose composure. They say the thing they've been trying not to say, right? It's when the casket blows. We need one of those. And the last category that I always forget is a moment of forgiveness, which is deeply vulnerable and very active at the same time. It also relates to this element of a secret. Usually there's in response to something that you've been keeping from something or haven't discussed for a long time. Moment of forgiveness is usually the point of most plays, actually. But it is, yeah.
Can you give us an example of the secret?
Yeah.
You keep using these other plays.
Sure.
Yeah.
So the play The Humans that's on Broadway, has anyone seen that one right now?
No.
It was nominated for the Pulitzer, I think. Anyway, very realistic play. There's no real magic. I mean, there kind of is, but it's very, very, very liminal magic. It's people gathering for a Thanksgiving play. There's a lot that can happen at Thanksgiving. And the secret is that the dad has been caught having an affair, but we don't know until the very end. And it's kind of why things are a little weird, why they don't have any money, right? The parents are having to sell this family property, then they're like, why are you doing that? Oh, because we just want to change, right? They're not going to say it. The mom doesn't want to deal with it. The dad's deeply embarrassed and ashamed, and at the end, that's what we find out. That's kind of in the well-made play category of a secret that happened before the play started that is about, that will be revealed by the end. Let's see, August Osage County, the reveal that the mother knew that the dad, right, what was it? It's like the dad commits suicide in the beginning of the play.
Had the affair with.
That's right. Yeah. Oh, yeah. There's several secrets.
Yeah.
August, had the affair with the sister, that the mother... He called the mother before he committed suicide. She didn't tell anybody, or she didn't go get him, or something like that. There was a way to stop his suicide, but she didn't. And right, all of these secrets that reveal, that come out. And sometimes there are secrets that nobody knows, that or a character knows that the rest of the characters don't know and the audience doesn't know. There's a secret that the audience knows that the characters don't know, i.e., we know that today is 9/11. The characters don't know what's going to happen. It's 6 a.m. and 9/11, and we're like, oh God, and the character, right? And so we're just like, no. there's secrets that obviously one character knows, the others don't. Some characters know this one, you know. The reason why secrets are good is because everyone wants to know. If you say, I have a secret, everyone's like, right? Suddenly it changes the dynamic in a relationship or a room. We're all gonna wait until you tell us what the secret is. And people do it naturally. It's human experience, right? To erase, to rewrite, to keep. This is when we had our character discussion, it's about, it's always about who we really are in the facade. Every character has both. And a lot of plays are about stripping that facade away, which is partly character, it's partly the secret. It's our internal crisis on display. It's a lot of these things. Moral inflection point, emotional rupture, vulnerability, a lot of that is about who we really are. That decision, right? The decision at the end, the defining decision is a moment. You can't have a facade in that decision. In that end, right? Iago was like, you know me. At the end of the play, you know exactly, and you know I know, and you know I don't care that you know, right? That's why he's so awful. He doesn't care. Right, okay. So yes, so those things of making sure that your play has moments of intimacy, those moments of losing it, aggression, attack, and keenly that moment of forgiveness. I always, it's so extraordinary. The power of somebody saying I'm sorry, and you can tell when it's often when it's meant, as opposed to like I'm sorry, please, sorry, is very different than I'm so sorry, please forgive me, please. That even in the bad acting of that was, that's kind of I'm leaning forward. I'm like, what are you sorry about? Oh my God. So making sure that those moments, again, not that your play has to have even any of them, but I will tell you if they do, suddenly it's an actable play. It's a play that is understandable. It starts to be universal. It starts to be active.
Because a good play isn't just plot points and information and emotion, but it's then this having an actable kind of play, which we can talk about that more if you want. But in terms of the writing of it, a lot of the actability you'll find out when your play is in rehearsal, when your play is in a reading, when you actually have it read by actors, you can immediately tell, like, well, they've been talking for 25 minutes, nobody's done anything. and you will be amazed if you put one of these moments in, especially those big decisions, those big inflection points of emotion, the ruptures, these moments of intimacy, you'll be amazing the electricity and the chemistry in the room that shifts. When suddenly, we know that those two, it's the end of Miss Bennett, both of those peaks have a moment where they like, oh God, the audience knows they like each other. Now they know they like each other. Okay, come on, who's gonna do it first? Who's gonna do it? Everyone's just, you know, bouncing in their seats waiting for them to kiss. Even though it's Jane Austen, we know they're gonna get together. This is that, again, that kind of primal magnetism of a story that's told well. We kind of can't look away. We just love it. So, I'm gonna breathe for a moment. You wanna talk about this for a second? Are there questions? We can go further. We can search for examples.
If we have more than two acts.
Yeah. Sure.
Are we just adding?
Yeah, I think you would add a bump.
Or two.
Or two, or ten, yes. Yeah, so like August Osage County has two act breaks, and each one has a like, oh shit, moment at the end. And each one, that's actually a fabulous example too, because those stakes are so high, and the characters are so nonstop. Mm-hmm. And talk about moments of intimacy and aggression, lots of moments of aggression. Right, is it the first act break or the second when she's like, I'm in charge now? It's like yelling over her mother at the Thanksgiving. Woo. So yes, talk about high stakes. If you want to know how to write a fight, also characters with secrets and how they come out. Very, very good example of that. But yes, both moments of like, oh God. And if it's two acts, two moments that shift completely. I think the first act is when the mother, what happens in the first act? Oh, right, we realize how like messed up she is on drugs. She keeps saying she's not on drugs, but she is. And the second act, like everybody's gone, except for the daughter. So it's like this, the third act is the daughter desperately trying not to become her mother. So the end of the play is her walking out, and her poor mom, poor, she's awful. that horrible, horrible woman left alone with her housekeeper. And that crazy, what is it she says? And they're gone. She's climbing to the top. Oh, very, very good. Speaking about great moments. So again, I should say that reminds me that, you know, all of this, when we're talking about the kind of engineering of story and these plot points and these character points, you have to have moments. Ideally, there are moments where the kind of engineering and the artistry come together, where you can accomplish one of these plot moments, one of these chaotic peaks, one of these moments of information, these driving moments that we need to keep the characters going, that reveal the character, a secret reveal. But if you can do it in a theatrically artistic way, that's how your voice is yours, right? How do we tell? There's a ton of ways of saying I love you. Do your characters say it in one big, beautiful monologue? Is it my favorite thing in the world, a symbol? Some physical symbol that a character passes to another. We've talked about this a couple times in class, but the use of symbolism is so important in plays, partly because it's efficient. You can have an entire beautiful monologue that you don't need to say because a single rose is given to somebody else, or you know, an envelope is handed over, or something. You know. So thinking about how we plant information in the beginning, but it's those kind of details that are going to make your story yours. And again, actable. Things that are physicalized. Again, this isn't a novel, so we actually have real bodies and real time in front of us, as Annie Baker reminds us in every one of those pauses, right? She's controlling time with those pauses, and they are, whether you know, like them or not, or you know, if they make you feel really uncomfortable, which is partly her plan, I think, and effectively so, or make you think. It's time for you to it's a time to for you to kind of recognize humanity, recognize, I mean, all sorts of things. So using those tools can help you accomplish
what words perhaps can't.